Thanks. It's great to be here. So I think as a quick introduction to the ARL scenarios, I think we have to ask what may seem like an obvious question with an obvious answer, but I think the answer is less obvious than it might initially seem. Planning does involve very real costs, and in my experience, it's just as easy to overplan as it is to underplan. And it's also true that those of us who are working in the knowledge economy are now functioning in a radically and apparently increasingly unpredictable environment. And it's an environment that I think many of us are finding can punish severely anybody who mistakenly jumps on the wrong bandwagon. And yet at the same time, as Carla Strieb points out in her introduction to the ARL 2030 Scenarios User's Guide, quote, "The temptation to wait and see is appealing, but exposes libraries to the risks of irrelevance and replacement. By delaying decision making, we may magnify the risks to our organization's future instead of reducing them," end quote. More to the point, I think in this context, in the current environment, we specifically need library planning that actively engages with uncertainty. And this reality is what I think makes scenario planning itself particularly attractive and potentially useful. Strategic planning is distinct from scenario planning, and I'm sure many of you already know all this, but for those who maybe haven't done much of both, strategic planning assumes that the fundamentals are pretty much predictable. It assumes that the environment that we're planning for is either going to be roughly the same as it is today, or that the changes to it can be anticipated with a reasonably high degree of certainty. And those assumptions may have made sense to different degrees at different times in different environments. I think they pretty clearly have little validity in the scholarly information marketplace at this time. In fact, I would say that it's folly to claim that we can predict with any real degree of certainty what the scholarly information marketplace is going to look like 3 years from now, let alone 5 or 10. There's any number of factors that will have a huge impact on that marketplace within as short a time as the next year. And these include the adoption and approval, or not, of a revised version of the Google Books settlement, the collapse, or not, of the big deal journal subscription model, the general uptake, or not, of patron-driven acquisition models, with those models inevitably seismic impact on patterns of scholarly publication, and the growth, or not, or continued growth, I should say, or not, of open access publishing. So what we try to do in scenario planning is we try to account for wide spectra of possibility. And we try to do that by defining multiple possible outcomes and by guiding participants thinking in a contingent way rather than helping them prepare for what seems to be an inevitable or even a highly likely future. So instead of asking, what are we going to do about the growing call for open access, or how are we going to prepare to deal with the inevitable collapse of the big deal? Scenario planning tends to ask questions like, what might the world look like if the big deal collapses? And what might it look like if it survives? And what options might be available to us in each case? Now, this is just my opinion, but it seems to me that scenario planning is generally most useful if the scenarios are drastic and negative. I like, when I'm talking with my staff, sometimes I like to paraphrase Clausewitz, the great military strategist who said, to paraphrase, you prepare for what your enemy is capable of, not for what you're pretty sure your enemy is likely to do. And I think in our case, and I think libraries and publishers share this, the enemy is just the complete uncertainty, the complete softness of the ground on which we're trying to across which we're trying to march. So in that spirit, I don't want to promote, you know, negativity or a paralyzing kind of pessimism, but I do think that we find ourselves best prepared for the future when we get ready for the worst and hope for the best, as the cliche has it. For libraries, I think that this means, for example, imagining what we would do if we found that patrons no longer need us to pay for access on their behalf because access has become cheap and ubiquitous, and if we find that they no longer ask for our guidance because information has become so easy to find that they no longer feel the need for it. And come to think of it, this sounds uncomfortably like the environment in which we librarians now find ourselves and for which we have not prepared, but that's a topic for another presentation. So to introduce you specifically to the ARL's scenario planning project, here's another quote from the introductory materials. When ARL launched its scenario planning project, it set out to design a set of scenarios that could serve as a resource for any member library to use to enhance its strategic planning process and to foster organizational alignment around change. I added that emphasis. That's the end of the quote. The challenges involved in doing this in libraries really can't be overstated. While it's not true that the library profession is utterly lacking in forward-thinking change agents, I think it's safe to say that our profession has not historically self-selected for really forward-thinking, out-of-the-box thinkers. And what those of us in management and administration in libraries tend to find is that getting people to accept radical or even in some cases what seems to us like fairly inconsequential change is just a huge, huge struggle. Now, I understand that that's not true anywhere in the STM publishing community. So, you know, you might have a hard time relating to that difficulty, but I can tell you that in libraries it's a real issue. The ARL 2030 scenarios are rich descriptions, by which is meant fully detailed and fleshed out descriptions, though the specific details of them are much less important than the larger structural realities that underlie each one. And as I present these scenarios, I'm going to focus on the structural realities rather than the specific. These scenarios are actually presented with narratives involving actual hypothetical people. And it explains, each scenario explains what this person does and how this person interacts with colleagues. I'm not going to get into that because it would take all day to read through them. But anyway, the scenarios are rich descriptions of four possible futures. As a set, and I'm quoting again from the ARL materials, as a set, the four scenarios are designed to tell widely divergent stories to explore a broad range of possible developments over time. The goal in using scenarios is not to pick one as more likely or more desirable, but to accept that the future will contain elements of all four scenarios. And with that, I want to just quickly emphasize how important it is when doing this kind of scenario planning or when encountering this kind of a scenario planning output that we avoid pitfalls like these. And I see this a lot among my colleagues. When they encounter a scenario that they don't like, then the first impulse is to pick at details. Well, people aren't going to be using handheld devices in that way. Or she would never wear a suit that looks like that, you know, or whatever. It becomes very easy to find little niggly details and then throw the whole thing out. The other one is to start too early in the scenario planning process to say, you know, I think scenarios 1 and 3 look very likely, and I'm real skeptical about 3 and 4. That's a decision-making process for farther down the line. But when you're in the planning process, it's important to try to keep your mind as open as possible about all the scenarios. And then related to that second pitfall is the pitfall of picking a winner or a loser based on the way you think people ought to behave rather than the way they demonstrably do behave. This is another real problem that we have in libraries, where we have a strong pedagogical tendency and we have a real desire to turn people into better library users. And as I tell my staff, the reason Google is eating our lunch is that they do not have the goal of turning people into better Google users. And so we look at these scenarios and we tend to think, well, that's the one that really sounds good to me. And it's you have to be careful not to let that throw your thinking off track. So the four scenarios that ARL has proposed they've given the names of research entrepreneurs, reuse and recycle, disciplines in charge, and global followers, and they present them on this on a matrix that looks like this. So the horizontal axis is a spectrum from the very aggregated at one end to the very diffused on the other end, as applied to research, to the research enterprise. So our universities and other research institutions continuing to be very tightly identified, or are are there functions and roles tending to sort of spread out into the community? And then on the vertical axis, it's a question of how much constraint will there be on individual researchers? And here you can kind of read constraint as money. It's basically what do the individual researchers have to draw upon? Do they have rich resources supporting them or relatively sparse resources? And so each quadrant on this matrix is one of the scenarios. And what I'm going to do now, because our time here is pretty limited, and because the full user's guide to this study is freely available online, and I'll provide you with the URL on the last slide, but it's very easy to find. I'm not going to go into all the details of each scenario, but I'm just going to share selected passages from the overview for each of them. This is kind of densely written, and so try not to fall asleep. Some of it's kind of tough going. Scenario one. So here, let me go back to the matrix so you can look at this while I'm reading. So scenario one, this is a future shaped by the rise of entrepreneurial research. Individual researchers are the stars of the story. New conceptions of translating research to market have opened avenues for more entrepreneurially rooted models of business investment in research, including venture capital. This has come about as leading researchers used the spotlight provided by the accountability movement to entrepreneurially leverage a range of funding sources. Researchers collaborated freely and frequently, but organized their own alliances when they saw opportunities to enhance their research agendas, and they took individual credit for their contributions. Yet, the burdens of institutional structures also motivated many researchers to leave institutional settings to go out on their own with funding from a range of sources. Well, you can see this is on the relatively unconstrained end of the individual researcher axis. While research projects attract large-scale investment, the money can go as quickly as it came when what funders find valuable shifts rapidly. Disciplinary labels have lost much of their meaning in the face of the accomplishments and interests of individuals. For instance, I love this part. Humanistic sources of research content and modes of inquiry, along with a deep knowledge of cultural context, are valued in many projects. In this world, creativity is highly valued and understood to be the defining characteristic of researchers rather than research modes. Research that changes or enriches society is valued, as well as research that provides commercial opportunities. Again, it's important not to pick at these things. With the fading of disciplinary boundaries, the training of new researchers becomes closely aligned with opportunities to work with successful individuals rather than following institutionally defined programs. Research institutions, while they still contribute to the research enterprise, increasingly function to provide support services to researchers and the projects they attract. Much work is contractual, but it's the researchers who write the contracts to suit their own terms. So that scenario sounds pretty good for individual researchers. Scenario two. This is a world where recycling and reuse predominate in research activities. Disinvestment in the research enterprise has cut across society. Government's ability to fund research and research-intensive education has become severely limited. As networked communication and other popular mass technologies evolve and spread knowledge widely, the perceived value of new information becomes reduced, accelerating the devaluation of the research enterprise and individual researchers. In this future, research projects reuse not just common knowledge resources, but also mass market technology infrastructure to underpin research activity. Creativity within the research enterprise focuses on identifying needs and interests that can provide revenue to support low-level research activity. Researchers are taking advantage of participatory research modes that leverage large-scale audiences willing to make small contributions of money, expertise, or other kinds of support to research projects. These research opportunities cut across disciplinary boundaries, as many research questions currently associated with humanistic inquiry have widespread appeal to segments of mass audiences, such as hobbyists or enthusiasts of various topics. These participatory research modes also attract creative researchers from the social sciences and the hard sciences. Competition for scarce resources and the proprietary nature of most application-oriented research keeps trust low within the research community. Even researchers affiliated with networked citizen projects jealously guard their association, although the data the projects produce is shared openly. Consequently, individual researchers tend to rely on personal relationships in organizing research collaborations. Research institutions have little to offer the research enterprise beyond loose organizing capacities, matching services, low-level overhead, and symbolic capital. So now proceeding clockwise, scenario three. This is disciplines in charge. By 2030, research using computational approaches to data analysis dominates the research enterprise. The new research modalities prove to be powerful drivers for organizing the research enterprise to address grand research challenges and support technology evolution. As a result, scholars, whether humanists or scientists, have been forced to align themselves around data stores and computational capacity that address large-scale research questions within their fields. These fields, often operating at a sub-discipline level, have emerged as leading organizers of the research enterprise. By building and controlling access to key technologies that accelerate the creation and application of new knowledge, the organizations that align with the fields and disciplines are in a position to recruit funding and define the large-scale research questions. These organizations drive technology development and attract societal support from governments, the corporate sector, and philanthropy. Researchers increasingly belong to two classes. A very small group of leaders control the disciplinary organizations and their research infrastructure. The majority of researchers are pushed to the background of the research enterprise, scrambling to pick up piecework that emerges in conjunction with research projects. Research institutions are forced to specialize and align themselves with research fields as the drive to focus research fields takes over. The connection between the research enterprise and undergraduate education and professional training weakens dramatically. Even the largest research institutions specialize. And then the last one, scenario four, global followers. In this future, the research enterprise looks relatively familiar, but the cultural context that frames the enterprise has shifted profoundly. Key structures such as universities, faculty, and graduate students persist, but the locus of the funding that drives the enterprise migrates from North America and developed Western nations to nations in the Middle East and Asia. These Middle Eastern and Asian cultures, which are able to build technical infrastructure that catalyze breakthrough research and attract top talent, can organize the activity into projects of relevance to their societies. Existing organizations and individuals act to realign themselves with the new sources of support. In addition, cultural norms from the new lead investors are increasingly powerful in shaping practices. Over time, the cultures that control the research funding increasingly shape beliefs about what research is important to society and what research and communication practices are acceptable and rewarded. The relative values placed on current disciplinary constructs are also reworked. What disciplines can contribute to answering particular categories of questions is rethought. There's increasing reconsideration of what the important questions are. Mobility and connectivity are crucial to the adaptability of the research enterprise to new centers of gravity. While researchers and institutions from the newly leading cultures are increasingly dominant in research projects, researchers and institutions from Western nations that are flexible enough to adapt to the new realities are free to pursue opportunities to leverage the new engines of the research enterprise. So each of these scenarios can, and in some cases probably should, generate a week's worth of discussion. But for those who are interested in creating a formal opportunity for that kind of discussion in your company or institution, the ARL study guide ends with a number of kind of handy outlines for local two-day workshops and 1 and 2 hour engagement activities. Of course, you know, like I said earlier, some of these scenarios sound more likely, and some of them sound more, you know, sort of dewy-eyed than others. But I'm convinced that the scenarios that ARL has come up with all contain significantly relevant predictions for the future, and I think it's going to turn out to be a very useful study, and I recommend it to you as a window into several possible futures for a significant part of your customer base. Thank you.